Boys and gents, welcome to G Reaction, and this is Why Did the British Empire Collapse by the channel Knowledgia. So yeah, British Empire is one of the biggest empire that ever existed, and I think it just fell because of world wars. Europe basically destroyed each other during both world wars, so you know, one of the casualties was also the British Empire. In World War One, you know, lots of resources, you know, dried out. World War Two, and eventually slowly every country started to claim independence and slowly just faded away. Pretty sure that's the case. But I like the British Empire's, you know, dominion mentality. You know, always gave autonomy to the whatever region they took over. So that way they don't have to worry about it, because, you know, usually whenever some country invades other country, take it over, it usually end badly for the country that invades. In a way, because, you know, they have to now take care of that country. They have to, you know, basically take care of everything. And it just becomes badly, like, you know, when USA invaded Iraq, that was just bad for USA. You know, USA's economy fell. What British did is, they, you know, they just put taxes, lots of taxes over this, you know, colonized areas. And then, you know, they just claim autonomy to those places. Like, you know, you go on yourself. We'll just take whatever, you know, our, you know, money, whatever, our percentage or something. So in that sense, you know, they took lots of places, but didn't have to worry about governing all of them. So that's one of the reasons why British Empire was so big. So yeah, let's watch this one. And remember, people, if you like my reaction, don't forget to like and subscribe. Check out the reaction today. There's a link in the description with all of my videos. Check out the cards for all the playlists. Check out the end cards. And yeah, let's watch this one.
The British Empire comprised the colonies, dominions, and other territories ruled or administrated by the United Kingdom. At its peak, this empire was the largest in history, and for over a century was the biggest global power. At the beginning of the 20th century, in the British Empire lived more than 400 million people, which was around 22% of the world population at that time. And by 1920, it covered more than 35 million square kilometers, meaning 24% of the Earth's total land area.
Yeah, see that? 5 million. Not just the Canada, big Australia and India. Africa, usually in the maps like this, Africa's always shrunken down. So this is really small compared to the real Africa. So this area we are seeing here, that is humongous area. So this people usually would see this map, they think, oh, look at that, giant Canada, India's big enough, also Australia, and somewhat Africa. No, that's not somewhat, that's a big area. It's just that this, you know, flat map is making look like it's small, otherwise Africa's really big.
Square kilometers, meaning 24% of the Earth's total land area. It wasn't a land-connected empire, but was bigger even than the Soviet Union or Russian Empire. During the Age of Discovery, in the 15th and 16th centuries, Portugal and Spain started the European exploration of the globe, establishing large overseas empires. After these two states, England, France and others began to establish colonies and trade networks on their own in Americas and Asia. In the 17th and 18th centuries, England's influence started to grow, and then following the union between England and Scotland in 1707, the new Great Britain became the dominant colonial power in North America, and then became the dominant power in India. They lost some important territories in North America after the American War of Independence, but Britain focused its attention on Africa and Asia, and even in the Pacific afterwards. After France,
you know, America's thing is a bit different. I mean, one might think that what if they didn't lose America and America was still part of the British colony? How powerful would British be today? But then the question is, would the non-free mentality Americans that we have today, would they be as capitalist as they are right now? Would they be as successful as they are right now if they were still under Britain control? That is a confusing thing. Who knows, they might be even more successful, but they might not be. But yeah, it's still, you know, fun to think that what if, screw every other country, just United States was under Britain control. British, you know, empire would still be too powerful, because that's how powerful USA is right now.
Went through its revolution, instability and lost wars, and after Spain became more and more weak, Britain emerged as the principal naval and imperial power of the 19th century. The empire dominated the seas and became the global hegemon, but after more than 100 years, this large empire fell. It resisted more than the Spanish and Portuguese empires, due to the fact that the Brits were better in administration, and because their mainland was an island, hard to conquer by other foreign powers. For example, Portugal and Spain lost its colonies in South and Central America due to some reasons, but the most important one is that they were involved in Napoleonic Wars, which caused moves of kings and instability. Due to their overextension having an unconnected overseas empire, UK gave the status of dominions to some parts of its empire. These dominions were semi-independent structures under the British crown, incorporated in the British Empire. In 1936, due to some pressures, these special territories were recognized as autonomous communities within the British Empire and in no way subordinate one to another. In the 19th century, as I said, some parts of the empire became dominions. These were states that were still part of this empire but ruled themselves. In most cases, this happened peacefully, but there was a serious violence in Ireland. The Indian Rebellion of 1857 was a major revolt between 1857 to 1858 against the rule of the British. In this territory, the East India Company functioned, which was a sovereign power on behalf of the British Crown. The event is known by many names, including India's First War of Independence. The event ended with a British victory. It was a strong sign that people wanted their freedom.
Yeah. I mean, that's the first time, you know, India revolted. Obviously, at the time, British suppressed everybody, but eventually, India would revolt again. So, yeah, that is, you know, I didn't know India was also part of the Dominion. I mean, they also govern themselves at some point. I mean, that makes sense. I mean, how could you stay in Britain and just worry about every country and how to govern them? That's too many resources. Yeah.
Their influence in the world started to fall down. Why I'm saying that? Well, a new power emerged. By the end of the 19th century, the US economy became larger than the British economy. And in Europe, a new rival was born. After Prussia defeated France in 1871, they unified Germany as a new big power of Europe, gaining even colonies in Africa after the Berlin Conference of 1884. Seeing this with some suspicion, Great Britain allied with its former rivals, France and Russia, in what will be called Entente, an alliance which will fight in the First World War.
Yeah.
Britain's fears of war with Germany became reality in 1914 with the outbreak. German overseas.
Yeah, that is heavy, isn't it? Germany was just new, kind of, because it was just a few decades old by the World War One. So, you know, Germany was kind of flexing at the time. Everybody was flexing. You know, Archduke of Austria got shot and everybody got excused. So, you know, everybody already wanted to fight each other and this just gave them excuse. But, you know, that war was so horrible. People thought, this is the Great War. There will be never another war like this. And technically, there was never a war like that because World War One was technically way different than World War Two. World War One was just countries fighting each other to, you know, so who has the bigger dick, I guess. In World War Two, it was just one guy going ballistic and everybody was scared and everybody fought that guy. That's what it was. So World War Two had just one sole, evil intent guy, while World War One had countries that just wanted to fight each other.
Colonies in Africa and Pacific were captured. The empire was at war. Also, the colonies and dominions provided military, financial and material support. More than 2.5 million men served in the armies of the dominions. The war had a big impact on the national identities of colonies, which wanted their transition to nations in their own right. After the war, the empire enlarged itself even more, taking some territories from the Ottoman and German Empire. For centuries, the British focused on their fleet, which was the biggest in the world. In the interwar period, United States started to expand their military, building more and more ships. Also, Japan started to expand. The British Empire became smaller and smaller compared to the US. At the Washington Conference was held in order to agree that the two nations will have naval parity. It was an agreement between two powers. Like the agreements between the USSR and US, few decades later, Ireland gained its independence in 1922 after a war. A conflict existed again and Britain managed to resist in Europe and to win in the West, together with the Americans. But in the Pacific and Southeast Asia, some of their territories were captured by Imperial Japan, including the city of Singapore. These losses caused a loss of prestige. Even the Prime Minister...
Malaya? I didn't... Japan took over Singapore at one point. Damn, that is heavy. I mean, a battle between USA and Japan is really weird, isn't it? They fought in, you know, at the Pacific while everybody was fighting at the, you know, European sides and, you know, at the Atlantic. You know, there was a war going between Japan and USA in Pacific, Pacific Sea. There was islands there, obviously Samoa and things like that, where there was constant attacks, and yeah, it was weird, man. I need to react to a video too. I know there is a, I already have my watch later list of video about, you know, USA and Japan war of ships. I don't know what it's called, but yeah, there was a massive ship battle there. That's just epic to see, because that's one of the areas that I don't know much about, Pacific wars between Japan and USA, so I really need to react to that.
Mr. Churchill called the shameful fall of Singapore to the Japanese the worst disaster and largest capitulation in the British military history. On May 8, 1945, the Allies formally accepted the unconditional surrender of the armed force of Germany, and in the afternoon of August 15, 1945, the surrender of Japan occurred. Great Britain was again a winner of the war. Even if they managed to resist and to win, it was all made at a huge cost for them. The Second World War confirmed that Britain was no longer the great power it had once been, and that it had been surpassed by the United States on the world stage. Canada, Australia, and New Zealand moved within the orbit of the United States. The imperial strength in Asia had been minimized by the Japanese attacks, and the British prestige there was irreversibly damaged, which helped to accelerate the decline of the empire. As I said earlier, now we are after the war, and the old continent is now divided between two blocks, between two countries, USSR and the USA. The UK cannot be considered the leader of the West anymore. The Marshall Plan was a result of the war, in which the biggest power of the West, USA, provided financial support to some countries, including UK. In the Cold War period, the Soviet Union and the United States were seen by the ordinary people.
That is weird, isn't it? Well, during the Cold Wars, Russia and USA was not declaring war, but they were just silently fighting each other. Everybody knew that. So in the middle, there was European countries, France, UK, and everybody was getting, you know, free shirt from USA. I'm like, this is fruitful.
As the major players in the world, Churchill tried to save the empire, but the large process of decolonization started as an effect of the rise of nationalism across the empire. India, which was Britain's most valuable possession, achieved independence, and this helped to accelerate the decline of the empire. The process of decolonization started after the British Labour Party was elected, but then the power switched again. The Suez Channel was an important strategic point for the British to control in the Middle East. Revolts happened in Egypt, and the new government wanted the British to go. The Suez Channel became independent and then incorporated in the Egyptian state. The UK wanted to capture the strategic point by military force, but they retreated in the end. Colonies in South America, Africa, and Asia gained their independence in the next decades. In 1982, there was a 10-week war between Argentina and the United Kingdom over two British-dependent territories in South Atlantic. The Falkland Islands were invaded and occupied by Argentina, which claimed...
Top Gear crew almost got killed because of it. That episode was ridiculous about Argentina. They had to run away from that. Is this real? I mean, what are they going to do? I'm pretty sure this is not going to be nothing. In the end, they were running away. There was mobs of people in the city. A mayor was involved. What the fuck? Don't you realize who BBC is? Don't you realize this is going to give you bad press? What's wrong with you? I mean, if somebody local and small comes there and you do that, understandable. A damn BBC show, Top Gear of all shows. Top Gear used to get 7 to 8 million views averagely. Game of Thrones used to get 6 million views. So it's more views than Game of Thrones, for fuck's sake.
Claim that this is their territory. The United Kingdom's government sent a force to engage the Argentine military and made an amphibious assault on the islands. This tiny war lasted 74 days and ended with the Argentine surrender, returning the islands to British control. In total, more than 900 men died in this conflict. The Falkland War regained the British prestige, showing that even if they are not the first player in the world anymore, they are still a power, capable to win a war and to cause great damage at a large distance from their mainland. The official end of the British Empire.
It's not just that. I think if I remember correctly, you know, British ships had cannons that reached the cities of, you know, Falkland, while Falklands didn't have the cannon as that fired as far away. So British just, but what they did was just put their ship at just right distance, so their cannons can reach the city while their cannons cannot reach their boats, and they just stayed there and the, you know, was just constantly shelling the cities. So, I mean, that's just like, you know, who was that? Ricky Gervais, that just say it's like, you know, holding a midget at arm length.
Marked by the return of Hong Kong to China in 1997, why this territory was transferred to a new administration? Well, the territory of Hong Kong was acquired after some treaties in the 19th century. In the last one, the province will be held by UK for a period of 99 years. After the handover, the United Kingdom marked this event by a huge ceremony. This was for many the unofficial end of the British Empire,
yeah,
which collapsed due to overextension and decolonization.
That's being a bit too technical, I think. What do you mean by British Empire? I mean, British do still have lots of islands under them. There are lots of countries, even Canada recognize, you know, British Queen as their queen. So if you're just counting the how many places does Britain occupy, British still occupies lots of places. I mean, in that sense, British Empire is still here. If you just mean the core power of it, how dominant they once were, then after World War, the British Empire just collapsed. It didn't wait until 1997. It was just technicality. So it's all on the how you see it. British Empire to me fell after World Wars because, you know, the entire Europe was under debt, I guess, by then. They destroyed each other. Countries saw that and claimed independence. And, you know, then, yeah, Britain had some areas, but now US and Russia is the superpower. So that's the end of British Empire. If you're going to see all the way to Hong Kong, then British still has lots of islands and places under them.
Without being defeated in a massive war. After its collapse, 14 overseas territories remained under British sovereignty. Also after independence, some former British colonies joined the Commonwealth of Nations, which still share a common monarch, Queen Elizabeth II.
So technically, British Empire is still here.
Thank you so much for watching this video, guys.
I like this channel knowledge. I reacted a few videos from this channel. It was all good videos. Alright people, that was the British Empire's collapse. Obviously World War helped that, as lots of other places. World War destroyed lots of Europe, so yeah, obviously US and Russia was basically the superpower after that. Cold War was just all ridiculous. I didn't know the USA, you know, gave lots of supplies to Europe, like, you know, in France, UK and things like that, just because of the Cold War. That is ridiculous. Just get free shit. Why? Because, you know, Russia and the USA is eyeing each other from the distances. Alright, if you like my reaction, don't forget to like and subscribe. Check out other reactions. There's a link in the description. Check out the cards for all the playlists. Check out the end cards. And yeah, I'll see you next time.